Welcome to Jeremy's IT Lab. This is a complete course for the CCNP NCORE, Enterprise Core exam. In this lab, we'll review some of the RSTP concepts we covered in the previous video. Let's get right into the lab instructions. First, we need to determine the STP topology of this LAN. I placed these letters here for alternate, backup, root, and designated ports. Then, we need to activate the long cost values, which were introduced in RSTP. And finally, manually configure the interface link types. Let's get started with step 1. Without using the CLI, determine the STP topology of the LAN. We've done this before in classic STP, but now let's do it in RSTP. The main difference is that the STP non-designated role is replaced by the RSTP alternate and backup roles. First of all, we have to determine the root bridge. I've written each switch's bridge priority next to it, and switch 4's is the lowest, so it's the root bridge. Next up, let's determine the root ports. Each non-root bridge has one. Note that the interfaces connecting switch 3 and switch 4 via hub 2, their G10 and G11 ports, have 100 megabit per second bandwidth. So that will affect the cost of this link, and each switch's root port selection. All other connections have the default 1 gig bandwidth, so they all have a cost of 4. Let's look at switch 2 first. It's directly connected to the root bridge via its G02 and G03 ports. One of them should be the root. They have the same root cost, 4, and the same neighbor bridge ID, switch 4. So let's compare their neighbor port IDs. G02 is connected to switch 4 G01, and G03 is connected to switch 4 G00. G03's neighbor port ID is lower, so it's switch 2's root port. And switch 4 G00 must be designated, because it connects to switch 2's root port. Okay, how about switch 3? It's also directly connected to the root bridge, but remember that these interfaces have 100 megabit bandwidth. Their STP cost is 19. So, what is switch 3's best path to the root bridge? Via either G10 or G11, it's 19, the standard STP cost of a 100 megabit interface. How about via G00? Well, it's 4 for switch 3 to switch 1, plus 4 for switch 1 to switch 2, and plus 4 for switch 2 to switch 4, for a total of 12. So, G00 has the lower cost and will be switch 3's root port. And that means that switch 1 G00 must be designated, since it's connected to switch 3's root port. Switch 1's root port will be G01 or G02. Let's go through the checklist. Lowest root cost, they're tied. Both have a cost of 8. 4 to reach switch 2, plus 4 to reach switch 4. Lowest neighbor bridge ID, tied again. They both connect to switch 2. Lowest neighbor port ID, once again, they are tied. Switch 1 G01 and 2, and switch 2 G00 and 1 are all connected to the same segment via a hub. They are all connected together. That means that switch 1 will use the final tiebreaker to decide, the lowest local port ID, which is G01. So G01 is switch 1's root port, so I'll add the final R here. Okay, we have found all of the root ports. Now let's find the designated ports. There must be one designated port per segment. We already identified switch 4 G00 and switch 1 G00 as designated, because they are connected to root ports on other switches. We identified switch 1's root port, but we haven't identified the designated port on the switch 1, switch 2 segment yet. The hub makes it a bit more complicated. How about we do that segment first? When determining a segment's designated port, the switch's root cost is the first priority. The port on the switch with the lowest root cost will become designated. So on the switch 1, switch 2 link, switch 2's root cost is 4. It's directly connected to switch 4, and switch 1's root cost is 8. So we know that the designated port is on switch 2. Or to put it differently, we know that switch 2 is the designated bridge for this segment. However, because there is a hub, switch 2 needs to decide which of its ports will be designated. As usual in STP, the lower value wins. So switch to G00 becomes designated. Now let's identify the other port roles on this segment. Switch 1 G02 and switch 2 G01 are either alternate or backup. The rule is, if the switch is the designated bridge, the port is backup. If the switch isn't the designated bridge, the port is alternate. So switch 2 G01 is backup because switch 2 is the designated bridge. And switch 1 G02 is alternate because switch 1 isn't the designated bridge. Next, let's do the switch 2 G02 to switch 4 G01 link. This is simple. Switch 4 has a root cost of 0. It's the root bridge. So switch 4 G01 is designated. And because switch 2 isn't the designated bridge for the segment, switch 2 G02 is alternate, not backup. The final link is this one between switch 3 and switch 4, again with a hub. Switch 4, being the root bridge, wins the root cost comparison, so one of its ports is designated. G10 has a lower port ID than G11, so G10 wins. It is the designated port for the segment. Because switch 4 is the designated bridge, G11 becomes backup. And because switch 3 isn't the designated bridge, its ports become alternate, both G10 and G11. Now that we've identified the role of each port, let's double check in the CLI. Let's go in order from switch 1. Show spanning tree. G00 designated, G01 root, and G02 alternate. Okay, switch 2 next. Show spanning tree. G00 designated, G01 backup, G02 alternate, and G03 root. Perfect. Switch 3 next. G00 is root, and G10 and 11 are alternate. Finally, switch 4, the root bridge. Show spanning tree. G11 is backup, and the rest are all designated. So, we've successfully completed step 1. I'll return to the lab notes for step 2. It says to configure the switches to use the long cost values. Starting from iOS XE version 17.5, the long cost method is the default. But in these iOS V switches, and any switches that run iOS or older versions of iOS XE, short is the default. To confirm, I'll go on switch 1. In the output of show spanning tree, you can see the costs here. 4 for gigabit Ethernet. And if I use show spanning tree path cost method, it says the default path cost method used is short. Let's change that to long. Conf T, spanning tree path cost method long. Let's check that it changed. Do show spanning tree path cost method. Okay, now the default path cost method used is long. Notice that it says default for both. Up here, it says short is the default, and then here it says long is the default. The word default here means the default cost of a port if you don't manually configure the cost. When using short, a 1 gig interface's default cost is 4, but you can manually change each individual interface's cost if you want. And when using long, a 1 gig interface's default cost is 20,000. But again, you can manually change each interface's cost. That's what default means in this case. Let's check their costs now. Do show spanning tree. Okay, the gigabit Ethernet interfaces all cost 20,000. So I'll go on each other switch, change the path cost method to long, and see if the topology changes. Switch 2 next. Conf T, spanning tree path cost method long. Then switch 3. Conf T, spanning tree path cost method long. And finally, switch 4. Conf T, spanning tree path cost method long. Next, let's check if the STP topology changed. It shouldn't. First, here on switch 4, do show spanning tree. Just like before, G11 is backup and the others are designated. I'll check switch 3 next. Do show spanning tree. G11 G00 is root, and G10 and 11 are alternate, just like before. Okay, switch 2 next. Do show spanning tree. G00 is designated, G01 is backup, G02 is alternate, and G03 is root, same as before. And then switch 1. Do show spanning tree. Designated, root, and alternate. Okay, so changing the path cost method modified the cost of each port, but didn't affect the STP topology. However, that won't always be the case. For example, using the short costs, 5 1GB interfaces cost 20. That's more than one 100MB interface, which is 19. However, using the long costs, 5 1GB interfaces cost 100,000, which is less than one 100MB interface, which is 200,000. So keep in mind that in some cases, the STP topology might change if you modify the path cost calculation method. Now let's move on to step 3. Step 3 says to manually configure each interface's link type to match its default. If I go on to switch 1, for example, its G00 interface, which is connected directly to switch 3, operates in full duplex. Therefore, it uses the point-to-point link type by default. G01 and G02, on the other hand, connect to a hub. They operate in half duplex, and their default link type is shared. If I use do show spanning tree interface G00 detail, at the bottom of the output it says link type is point-to-point by default. This isn't necessary to do, but to familiarize yourself with the command, step 3 says to manually configure the link type. We didn't cover this command in the lecture video, but it's spanning tree link type. I'll do G00 first. Interface G00, spanning tree link type, point to point. Okay, let's see if the output changes. Do show spanning tree interface G00 detail. This time, the output just says link type is point to point. Now let's configure G01 and G02. First, I'll use do show spanning tree interface G01 detail. It says the type is shared by default. Let's change that on G01 and G02. Interface range G01 to 2, spanning tree link type shared. And let's check once more. Do show spanning tree interface G01 detail. Okay, it no longer says default. I won't demonstrate the command on all switches. Just remember that full duplex links use the point-to-point type by default, and half-duplex links use shared. To manually configure the link type, use spanning tree link type. Okay, in this lab, we identified the RSTP topology and used a few RSTP commands. A network like this, using hubs, is a bit unrealistic. We don't use hubs anymore. However, you should still understand the RSTP backup port mechanism, so I included a couple of hubs here. That's all for this video. Thanks for watching. Before finishing this video, let me thank my JCNP level channel members. To become a member, please click the join button under the video. Thanks to Jonathan Makara, Velva Jacob, George, Nasir Chowdhury, Gustavo Macedo, Marcel Lord, Pavel M., Dragos Hirnea, Zakib Shah, Mayor Salman, Vitaus194, Chance Carter 56, Mark Jackson, Bold1C1U, Michael Carroll, Gerald Guillaume, Fristas1207, Gabriel Braga, Hector Hernandez, Roji Kuriakos, Arpad Conives, 5 Feet, Owad, Daniel Brown, Jose Alvarez, Hussein Yavuz, Kevin Hayes, Samuel Tavares, Roger Bratseth, Nasser Zahar, Brian Grant, Georgi Gemejev, Cats for Life, Arlen Plagaria, Dear Diso, Adelson Pereira, Farad69, Joyce Njoroge, Lucien Stoichitoyu, Madmark50484, Alexandru Stratan, Hiago Bicalho, DMJ2, Kurt Nell, Omid Farakesh, Steve Cox, Jasper Yim, Pedro Hartman, Ivano Capuano, Enigma G, Jefferson Steelflex, Burl Campbell, Abhishek Sahu, Toxic, Sinan Sarisenar, Gio, Daniel Andrade, Mike Crumby, Jairo Francisco, Dragos George, Philip Jovanovich, Random User 7547, Wagner Botelho, ICT-EDU Official, Mateusz Wzeszynski, Dean I, Ruben Hernandez, Electro Jedi, Girish, Trevor Goldman, Gavin Paul Tech, Rafi Babkir, and Sunny Idigu. Sorry if I pronounced your name incorrectly, but thank you so much for your support. Thanks to you and my other supporters, I am able to make these videos and release them for free on YouTube, so I really appreciate the support. Another great way to support the channel is to like the video, leave a comment, subscribe, and most importantly, share this video with others. So if this video was helpful, I'd appreciate it if you did any of those. Thanks for watching. Thank you.